All right. That's a long way to get there. All right, let's get this thing officially started.
Access to this webinar is for educational and informational purposes only. Consult a licensed broker or registered investment advisor before placing any trades. All securities in order to set to track and monitored in virtual trading accounts. Virtual account prices and returns may differ from actual trading results. Commission costs are excluded. Neither PhilStockWorld.com, CSW, nor its affiliates, nor any of the respective offices. Personnel, representatives, agents, or independent contractors are in such capacities licensed financial advisors, registered investment advisors, and registered broker dealers. Nothing contained in this webinar, website, or promotional material constitutes a promotion, recommendation, solicitation, or offer of any particular investment, security, or transaction. Trading options involve risk. Visit the SEC website www.optionsclearing.com to read characteristics and risks of standardized options. CSW provides education and training services that are meant to teach you to the risks and potential rewards of trading options and the amount of service that tells you what to trade. We are not implying a guarantee of any profit. As always, do not trade with money that you cannot afford to lose. Past performance does not equal future results, and results discussed in this webinar are not typical and are only valid on a specific or identified day. Your results may vary. By accessing this webinar, you agree to hold the advance harmless from any loss you may incur as a result of information discussed in the media identified above. By accessing this webinar, you agree to be placed on our mailing list and receive our newsletter. Rest assured, we take your privacy very seriously and we will not distribute or send your information to anyone.
All right, let's see where we are. So, holy crap, all right. We have a nice rejection of 2,400 there. That's a good sign. Look at this, though. I mean, this is, like, absolutely insane. You've got, see, one, you know, look, these are standard deviations. Here's one standard deviation, two standard deviations. This would be, like, three, four, five, six, seven standard deviations. It's an incredible move for a day. And obviously, completely not taken into account in the charts. Coffee made a nice comeback. Coffee came down to 142 and popped back. My average entry on coffees is 145, though. Oil was shorting right at this 54 line and went down a little bit, but it wasn't enough to make his father changing the bet. Most of them worried about the other puts today. I'm thinking this is topping for the indexes, though. I think that this is a good sharp line on the Russell. Nobody else is betting their lines, but 2,400 on the S&P is more ridiculous than 21,000 on the Dow. So we'll see how it works out. And how's everything else doing? Dow came back down to 21, so we'll see what happens. Oh, 21.1, actually, not 21. Gasoline came down a bit. Natural gas pulling back a little bit. I got out of natural gas. The main reason I got out of natural gas is because I was getting killed on my Dow shorts. And I just said, well, here's money, so since I'm losing money here, I may as well cash this one and have something back. I like the Nikkei short here. The Nikkei is tricky, though, because if the dollar's weak, the Nikkei likes it, but the dollar's holding up at 10050, and if these indexes come down, I think this is a good time to maybe take a short on the Nikkei. It could be fun. Let's do that. Let's see how that works out during the webinar. So instead of watching the Russell, we'll watch the Nikkei and the S&P. KD, and we should also watch, if you're watching the Nikkei, you got to watch the dollar. So what you got to do, you know, you get on your panel, and you just go right there at the 19.6 line, or 19.605, if I can get it. Oh, that was easy. So on one short, we'll take two shorts, just for fun. These are $5 per point, and hopefully we can get a pullback to 19.5, which would be good, $4,000 on two contracts. What I say, we're going to watch over here, the dollar. This is a coffee long. So this is basically the line. My entry on coffee long is just under 145. I did not double down this morning because we were just so busy doing other stuff. I would have, because I would like more coffee longs. That's a July contract, those are. Right now, we're going to watch the dollar because we have the Nikkei on. And if the dollar goes up, the Nikkei likes that. If the dollar goes down, the Nikkei does not like that. So we'll see what the dollar does. But I don't think, as the dollar was at 102 and the Nikkei only made 35 points higher than this, I don't think that it's going to be very impressive, the dollar drifting around 101.50. So if our U.S. indexes pull back, we should see the Nikkei pull back a bit. And look at this run off them. They went from 19.1 to 19.6. So they had a 500-point run. It's a 5% move. So So what happens on a 5% move? Oh, and look what happened at the 2.5% line. Here's 250 points of the 500. Look at this pullback. They consolidated, they pulled back, a strong pullback, and then they kept going back up. So what we're going to look for here is the same thing. We're going to look for 100 point at least consolidation, maybe 200 points if we get a strong pullback, and then they'll go back up. But I'll be thrilled, like I said, with two contracts, I would be thrilled to get to come out here and pick up $1,000 on that trade. So let's see. Like I said, if anybody says anything before this, I won't see it. Eric says, I think this is different with Goldman, Algos, the Fed. Look, they always say this time is different. And look, it's like it was in 1999, it's like it was in 2007. The market just goes up and up and up, and ignores everything. And everybody starts saying, oh, my God, I can't believe I'm not more bullish. And everybody gets more and more bullish, and the market goes higher until everybody's bullish, and then the whole thing collapses. So, you know, we've just had such a good 3 years. I mean, you know, on our portfolios especially, we've had such fantastic conditions in our portfolios, and we're so far ahead, it would be idiotic to blow the money now because we're greedy. So I'm going to continue playing conservatively. I mean, and our conservative play, where are we? Let's take a look. Look at our portfolios. It's a good idea today anyway. Next week we're going to do a more public webinar, so I don't want to look at the portfolios then. All right. So this doesn't reflect the moves we just made today. I just put out a note to make changes in our portfolios, and we have to change the long-term portfolio too, because we didn't do that one yet. But in the 5-10 portfolio, it's up 160%. So it's up 160%. It's not, you know, it's up $160,000 from where it was. I'm not going to risk that just because I want to get the absolute 100% gains off the market. We get phenomenal gains anyway. A month ago, we were under 250, so we're up $11,000-$12,000 at the moment, according to this thing. Something lost money since this morning because we were at 164 this morning. But, you know, intraday stuff, you can't really go by it. You don't know where you're going to end up. These are all great positions. All of our primary positions are in the money. Taser, we're just waiting for those to expire worthless. USO is in the money, or almost 100% in the money. Exxon, not in the money, but we'll see what happens to them. Frontier, Frontier is down. Frontier is down about $2,200, and we're going to add to that, though. That's a very long-term hold for us. Apple is in great shape. In fact, our biggest problem is our short puts, our short calls are a problem. ABX is fine. Cliff's on track. CSIQ is on track. DBA is on track. Disney's on track. GoGo's on track. Coffee's on track. Kate's on track. Macy's on track. SGYP is on track. Silver Wheaton, of course, is on track. That's in a little bit of the midway point right there. Sonic is on track. Sun Power is on track. I mean, so everything's on track, so it's only about losing money on the hedges. But all these other positions, and I remember we calculated at the beginning of the year, we said if all these things stay on track, they're going to make us another $150,000 by 2019. That's like, you know, another 150% added to our original $100,000. And it's going to be more than $50,000 a year in gains off a $100,000 portfolio. What else do we want? The only thing I want at that point is to protect it. If I know that's what I'm going to make, as long as the market doesn't fall, then the only thing I'm going to say is, what do I do if the market falls? So this strategy is going to continue. I don't care how high the market goes. I don't care how much like a dot-com bubble we have. I'm still going to hedge this portfolio and make sure that these gains don't evaporate overnight when the market turns. Now, in the butterfly portfolio, that's a 223%. See, that's up 223%, and this is our conservative portfolio. All right. The other ones, the other portfolio is only a year old. This one's 3 years old. It's up 223%. These are all nice, sturdy positions. We don't worry about them at all, so it's not a big deal. They're all pretty much on track. Let's see if they're all on track. Let's see. Apple, our target was, we sold the 115 call, so we're way over that. We sold the 90 put. So those will have to be adjusted, but it was only a half sale, so we'll be fine. Costco is over. Oh, wait. No, wait. Yeah, Costco's over, but also we only did a partial sale. CTSH is right on track. We sold the 5750, so that's okay. We're fine there. Disney, we were just bullish. We actually had to cover Disney. We forgot to do that. Let's see something. Go to my Wednesday post so I can get a chart. There, that's the chart. Wow. Stupid scroll wheel. Right, let's try it this way. There we go. Open a new tab. And change it to Disney. There. So I've been waiting to cover Disney, but I want to see how they do up around, you know, head north 115. But we do need to cover Disney. We don't. We were gung-ho bullish on that position in this portfolio. And so the right thing to do is to cover it. So at least sell some calls, you know, just to generate the income. But look at this position. It's up $16,000, $25,000, $30,000. We're up on that. GIS 60, that's exactly where we want them to be. Microsoft is 65, and we sold the 60, so we're a little bit high on Microsoft. You know, and of course we're high, you know, of course some of these are high because the market's gone crazy. Procter and Gamble, 87.50 was our call target. We're at 91. Target's way down. We'll see. Target, we're going to turn into a bullish play. Oh, so that's interesting. So here's the point: in the butterfly portfolio, sometimes we're going to turn something bullish. Fortunately, we only sold five puts. But we have the April 65 puts. So what's going to happen to those? They're $7 now. We're going to roll those out to maybe 10. Of the 2019 puts, wait. Well, these are already puts. Okay. These 2019 65 puts are 1290. These April 65 puts are 718. So we will. We're going to roll these five to these five. I'm still happy with the 65 target in 2019. So that's fine. And we already have this bullish spread. And what we're going to do is probably spend some money to make the spread a little bit wider. So we're going to roll these down. Here's Texas Instruments, and they're at 77, and that's pretty much where we want them to be. Well, we sold 72.50 calls, so we have to deal with that. But it's July, so we're not worried about that. UNG, we were straight up bullish. We'll have to cover those eventually, but not yet. Valero 62.50, and they're at 68, so they're over. Walmart. What the heck is their target on Walmart? Oh, here, 67.50, and they're at 70. So Walmart's a touch over, and Wynn just popped. We sold the 105 calls, and they're at one. Oh, we sold the 105 calls. They just popped. So Wynn popped to the top of their channel, which is where we sold the calls. So those are fine, too. All right. So these are in okay shape. It could be better, but you know what? It's early. We still have 2 weeks, 3 weeks left in the cycle. So it's over 2 weeks from Friday. So nothing to worry about on that. The short-term portfolio obviously is going to be getting killed. And here we have to make, we're going to make essentially the same adjustments to the hedges. We have the SQQs over here, and we have the TZAs over there. And so we're going to basically make the same adjustments we just made in the options opportunity portfolio. I'll put out a note of that before the close. And in the long-term portfolio, that's going to be some stunning gains, I bet. Let's see. 151. That is now 1.257 million. We started with 500,000, so it's up 151%. There's only two red options, and they're barely. There's only two red puts, short puts. One is Target, which isn't even that bad, and we only sold five, so we're going to be thrilled to sell more of these. not the same one, but we're going to roll down to a lower strike and sell some more. And the other one is RH, and this is silly. I can't even believe you can still do this. I love this put sale. You can sell the Restoration Hardware, the RH, 25 puts. The stock is at 30. And you can sell the $25 puts for $660. That is some incredibly great premium, man. That means you're netting in for 25 minus 660 is 1840. That's your net entry. So it's like a 725, you know, 20-something% discount. I mean, that's really amazing. It's like a 25% discount on the stock. That is incredible money. I highly recommend this trade. So our worst trade is one that I immediately love. Oh, wait, there's another one. What's this one? Best Buy. Ooh. Best Buy just tanked earnings. They just popped back. Wait. Oh, no, that's not Bed. I'm sorry. It's Bed Bath & Beyond. So they're fine. Bed Bath & Beyond, they're just drifting along at the line that they were. And I like them, too, so there's no problem there. Otherwise, we've got a bunch of cool, fun stocks. GNC is still behind, but we have faith in those guys. NRF has to be adjusted. The NRF, we're actually in better shape. We're in much better shape than that because the NRF is showing it a zero, and certainly not a zero. We have zero credit for this owning that thing right now. So that we get to adjust the puts and calls. Ugh, I don't know what I'm going to do. Hopefully this weekend I have some time. But pain in the ass doing those things. And then otherwise we have a lot of the same calls of things that we have in the options opportunity portfolio, but some different stuff. And obviously bigger stuff, you know, like Frontier here we have, Fidelity, things like that. So the portfolios are in excellent, excellent shape. And again, it's why we want to spend money to protect them. This is not nothing. This is $1.25 million. So we take our short-term portfolio and we protect the $1.25 million by buying hedges. That's the way it works. And I know it's a pain in the ass because you hate losing the money. And the short-term portfolio is down like $40,000 this year. But that's because the long-term portfolio is up $100,000. So it's a balance. You know, on the whole, we net up $60,000. That's fine. We want to be that on the two portfolios. And it's only been a month, right, or 2 months. So if you're going to make $30,000 a month and you're going to complain, that's not smart. Then trading probably isn't good enough for you. You're going to have to go to Vegas. Let's see. Help on the NQ shorts. I have three shorts at 5325. Let's see. Okay, so she has three shorts at 5325. Well, you say help. It's not like I can do anything about it, but let's take a look. Somebody remind me I have those NKDs later. NQ. So you have it 5325, way, way down here. You have two shorts, right? Now, step one is basically if you're going to short and you don't want to double down, you should have a tight stop. So honestly, when it broke over 5330, it would have been nice if you stopped out. That would have been cool. But if you're not going to stop out and it goes to 5350 and it goes to goes up to 5380, which is 50 points higher than you started off or whatever. I forget, you said 25. So say 75. So it's 75, and you start at 25. If you double down here, then your average would be 50. It would be 53.50. Now, it's reasonable. You can imagine it's possible you can get back to 53.50. It's not that likely you can get back to 53.25. So, you know, if your plan is just stand around here praying, that's not a good plan. You know, I've got Dow's, I'll show you, because those have just got a horrific loss, but I'm not dumping them. Where are we down? We're down about $20,000 on this Dow. So, whoa, why do I have 22? I thought I had 20. All right, hang on a second. Let's have 20, not 22. I'm not getting the button too much. There you go. Buy. And, oh, come on. I want my 2107. Anyway, so I've been raising my basis. See, if you ask for it, you get it. So I'm at 20,938. That's up here. I'm still not that happy with it, but I don't want to be, I'm not going to go to 40. What I'm going to do is I'll add 5. If I think I'm in a good downtrend, I'll add 5, or I've already added. I'm up to 20. So I added 10 around here. And as soon as they get down to here, I'm going to be happy because I just want to get my basis up a little bit. Then if it goes up again, I'll add some more. And if it goes down, I'll add some more. And I'll just keep doing that along the top until we get back down, until we manage to get even. When we get even, I'm going to go back to my original 5. That's where I started with 5 short. And hopefully we'll actually make some money. You know, and that's the other thing, by the way. You double down. See, now I'm only down 17,000 from the open. That's pretty good. All right. So when you do actually make some money, you need to remember why you were in the trade. Like you don't if you double down and you get even, you should immediately get back to your original amount, not let the double down ride. That's more than you intended to risk at the time. You know, so my intention when I started out with 5, I know I could end up going to 20. I know that can happen. It did happen. Now what happened to me today, unfortunately, is because see here it's like 6:30. This is when I'm writing my post, 6:37, 7:38, 9, 9:30. So by the time I was done writing my post, this thing had gone up over 21,000. And then I started, you know, then I get into chat and I started answering questions and spiked up again. And I'm like, ah, crap. So essentially, I wasn't paying attention. I let it get away from me, which is what happened to you on the NASDAQ. I'm sure it's a similar thing for whatever reason. Maybe you got kids, you went to school, whatever. But you know, something gets away from you. But the point is, it got away from me because I wasn't paying attention. But don't not pay attention if the money is really important to you. If you can't afford to double down, I could afford, thank God, to double down and take a bigger bet. If you can't afford it, then you need a stopping strategy, not a doubling down strategy. All right, but mechanically and simply, It's tricky now because I wish you would, you know, obviously it would have been nice if you did here. But the bottom line is if you add 3 more here short, 5387, don't think you have to ride out 6 short now. You put a stop at 5390 at this line on the 3 new ones, right? So then you would stop out of them. It keeps going up. You wait until it tops. Then you add 3 back again and hope it comes back better next time. So you can have a tight stop discipline on the 3 new ones. And then eventually, hopefully, you'll get a nice breakdown and it'll work out. So the idea is just make a little bit of money. The 3 new ones are sort of like an independent unit. Don't think of it as all the same batch. If you add 3 new short ones and you tease them down a little bit, and if the market is good to you and it comes down a bit, then you take your profit. Like, you know, treat those like a quick trade. Because every time you make a few $100, it takes away from the loss that you have. Like here, if I add 5, if I go 5 more short and I make $1,000 in my 5 short, I've knocked 5% off my loss. I only have to do that 20 times and I'm even. So I'm not looking to get, I don't have to get back my whole $20,000 loss in one shot. I can get back $1,000 here, $2,000 there, you know, and that's of course proportional to the amount that I have outstanding. If in a normal one, if you had like, if you were down a few thousand, you would be looking to get a few hundred back each shot. Don't be greedy. Be very happy with like a tiny little move and take that off the table and then wait for the next chance when it's going to be a nice move. So it's sort of like you have to switch to being a short-term trader, which is why when you're doing the futures, though, it's better if you start out being a short-term tight stop trader because that discipline is very, very important even if you start trading for the biggest swings. Because within those biggest swings, you still need to do that short-term trading. So there's no benefit to holding and waiting. I mean, it's a bet. Every minute you're making another bet. And you've always got to look at this thing and say, do I think that's the best use of my money? I'm down, you know, whatever thousands of dollars. Wait, 53.25. So a 50-point move is times 20 is $1,000. You're down like $3,000. So the thing is, you're down $3,000. How much do you think the risk is? The risk if you go down another 25 points, because usually in a day the NASDAQ only needs 25 points. So tomorrow, if you're willing to go to sleep on this tomorrow, you could wake up and down another 25 points, which is $500, so another $1,500. Or if you're luckier, you'll make up $1,500. But the question is, how do you feel about that risk reward? Do you think it's more likely you're going to make your 25 back? And can you afford to lose? What are you going to do if you go down $1,500 more dollars? You have a stop. You have a tolerance limit that you can take. All right, so all that's taken into account. I think those of you who remember from the fall, I got burned on the Russell. In fact, the Russell did the same thing to me that this is doing now in the fall, and I was down on that one about $50,000 or $40,000 at one point, and I stuck with it, and it came back. But, you know, and again, in fact, at the time we were talking about it, I said my family doesn't know this, but this is their trip to Hawaii. Because I, you know, if I lost that $40,000, we weren't going to Hawaii this summer. I mean, that was going to be off the table. Luckily, I hadn't told them we're going to Hawaii yet, so that's okay. So we'd be going to the Jersey Shore, and maybe we'll have a great time and thinking we're on a great vacation on the shore. And the whole time, I'd be like, damn, we should have been in Hawaii. but you know, when you're trading, that should be the amount that affects you. Like whether you go to Hawaii or you go to like a local beach place instead. Not whether or not you make your mortgage payment, not whether or not you're going to get a car. You know, these are, it starts to become a big deal. So I always look at like purchases. I always look in terms of like things we're going to do anyway. Like I'm going to buy my daughter a car in July. So I'm either going to buy her a nice car or I'll buy her a cheap car. And if I lose $20,000, she'll get a cheaper car. But it won't affect my lifestyle. And you can't play like this if it's affecting your lifestyle, because it forces you to then make bad decisions, because you're just going to constantly feel pressured and constantly be stressed and so on and so forth. So tight stop trading is the best way to trade the futures, and especially if you have limited resources. You really have to keep a very tight handle on those stops. If you have the money, though, and something like that doesn't bother you, then absolutely. You add three more, you check your basis. Your basis, if you start at 25 and you buy three and you sell three more to 85, your basis is going to be 55. So you'll end up at a 55 basis. And then you say, okay, that's your target. But you can't expect to get back to 55 in one great shot. So if you get down 10 more points and you stop out and you take the money off the three new ones that you have, what have you done? You've raised the basis on your old ones by 10 points. So now their basis has gone from 25 to 35. That's nice, right? Now you only have three, and their basis is 55. So at that point, like I said, you'd be at 75 if that happened. And then you would say, okay, now if it goes down more to 65, let's say, you're happy because you're barely down anymore. If it goes up again to 80, you say, oh, maybe I'll add three more shorts again and try it again. Hopefully I'll get another pullback. But you have to constantly be evaluating that and getting in and out of these trades. You can't just, you know, sit on it and cross your fingers. You've got to actively trade it all the way up and all the way down. And if you can't do that, you shouldn't be trading it. You should be just sticking with the very tight stop protocol. Like here's my oil. I'm just sitting on those. They have, you know, this 53.95 short. That's from the weekend, I think. I don't even remember when I had that on from. Oh, no, wait. I'm sorry. No, I'm sorry, from yesterday, silly me. We took this money off the table, then we got back in over here, and since yesterday I've been sitting on it. When it popped this morning, again, I missed it because I was busy. So I missed a lot of the fun. I should have doubled down here. I would have loved that, because then I'd be in great shape now. But as it is, it's up a couple $100. Let's see. Looking for Island Top tomorrow. Well, that'd be nice, but you know, that's when the indexes go like across or you make a toppy formation. But we'll see. I just think the rally's got to be exhausted at some point. Anyone have problems with a PIN number? It says it's not valid. I'm not sure what PIN number that would be, but you're here. Shows NGV7 position to discuss your strategy. I don't have an NGV. Blah blah blah. Now, there's an interesting thing. Now, here's another point I'll make. That's good. NGV7. Whoa. No, I did that wrong. Which is 1,000 of the day. This position was up $3,000. And I closed it, you know, up here. Because, and why did I close it? Because I lost freaking $20,000 over there. So I've got to get that money back. So I'm certainly going to take a $3,000 winner off the table to make up for it. Oh, and the Russell also made some money on the Russell today. So you know, in the morning I offset when this thing was down here. I bought a bunch of Russell longs. So a lot of this is offset by the Russell gain. So I had the $3,000 here from that, and I had $5,000 from the Russell. So that basically knocks down $8,000. I got to have a gain on oil, so, and a gain on coffee. So on the day, it's really only down about $10,000. It's just this particular one is down that much. So I took it off the table. I took it off the table not because I thought the rally was dead, but I took it off the table because I'm not going to sit there and have this loss while I'm sitting on that gain. So it went out. But either way, though, the bottom line is it went up and it had a huge spike. I mean, look at this move. It went from 291 to 313 in one day. So that's a gigantic, ridiculous move. So I wanted, you know, so I, as it came up here, it was smart to take it off the table anyway. I want to get back in it. I hate not having this thing long, but until I resolve this, I'm really not too keen on it. And now hopefully it'll pull back a bit. But you can't be attached to these trades, and you can't get attached to numbers, and you can't expect anyone to tell you exactly where something's going to go. When it's low, I buy it, and when it's high, I might short it, or and if it gets a good run and I make a little bit of money, I get out. That's my strategy. Okay, but over the long haul, looking at natural gas, so, you know, it came down here. Obviously, anything down here is still a buy. I expect it to be up here. And if you look longer and longer, it's pretty freaking low. So my long-range view is it's going to get higher than this at some point. Let me tell you, for one thing, there will one day be a hurricane. And a hurricane will double the price of natural gas while you can, overnight. There hasn't been one in a few years. Everybody's gotten real complacent about hurricanes. But there will be a hurricane, which is why I was buying the October contract. I'm not saying there will be one this year, but I'm saying there will eventually be a hurricane. So I like to hold my contract to at least get me into hurricane season that starts in August. But at these prices, I'm not actually looking at the chart now. I'm like, why did I get out of that trade? But again, I got out of the trade because I had a $3,000 gain, and I have a loss here, so I wanted to offset my loss by putting the cash out, and now I feel better, and I can play this more comfortably. I don't like losing $10,000. It makes me upset. Hey, that's why. That's my strategy. Don't lose $10,000. Would you make the same argument on TF as NQ? No, I don't know what the argument is. I mean, I think they're all overvalued. But TF is actually, if you look at the indexes, wait a minute, that chart again. If you look at all the indexes, days, okay, the Russell is less up. Look where everybody was in December, right? The Russell was here at 1380. Now it's at 1412. It's up 30 points. That's like 2%. This guy is up from 4900 to 5400. He's up 500 points. So he's up 10%. He's up 2%. All right. Now, let's count it from the lows maybe. That might be a little more helpful. So from 1300 to 1400 is 114 is what, like 7%, 6%? 7%. We'll say, all right, so say 7%. 7.5. All right, whatever, 7.5%. So Russell's up 7.5%. The NASDAQ is up from 47 to 53, 54. That's 700, so that's like 15%. The S&P is up from 2100 to 2400, so it's up 300, and that's 15%-ish, 12.5, 15%, whatever. The Dow is up from 19,000 to 21,000. 219 is more than 10%, 11%, 12%. So the Russell is absolutely lagging. far, far behind, which is why I haven't been shorting it. You know, usually I love shorting the Russell, right? I don't like shorting the Russell when it's lagging. You know when I like shorting the Russell? When it was ahead of everybody over here. Not, you know, I don't have a complex system here. The Russell is up much more, the Russell, you know, relative to the charts, but it's not really proportional, but relative to the charts, the Russell was up here and up here and up here while these guys were down here. And since I was bearish, I played the Russell down all this time. Then the other indexes passed it. Now, since that time, I have not shorted the Russell. I was short every time the Russell hit this area in 1400, I was shorting it because it was fantastic short down there. But that's because it was so far ahead of the other indexes, they exerted a pull on it. Now the pull is up. Now the Russell is a lagging index. So you can't just short it for the hell of it. You can't just, you know, you have to have a premise. Now, Apple's a problem for the NASDAQ because Apple's going to keep going up. Somebody asked what my target for Apple is. I mean, Apple's going to go up to 150 easily. You know, by the end of this year, it should be at 150 next year. I mean, my target for next year was 150, 160. I mean, 2018, whatever the hell year. January 2019, I expected to see 150, 160. Now, it looks like we're going to hit 150 now before it's going to pull back. So how's the NASDAQ going to go down if Apple keeps going up? It's probably not. And by the way, when I say go down, I mean not go down every day. I just mean it's not going to go down in general. The biggest stock in the NASDAQ is the strongest stock in the NASDAQ. All right, so let me go back to NKD here and see how that's doing. Hey, up $100. All right, well, better than nothing. All right. Mayho says, what and what? What and what to what? I don't know. I can't follow that kind of stuff. All right. Oh, now she's surfing me up. What's your target for Apple? Okay, we just talked about that. So Apple should, I mean, look, 150 is a very fair price for Apple. It's below that now. It should still continue to go higher. That means, though, how's NASDAQ going to have a real big loss if Apple's not going to go down? But I can't see what it would be that would make Apple go lower. Also, what's your outlook on SunTower in the OOP? I didn't get into the debit spread. Just the put, is it still a good one to go long? Yeah, I still like SunTower. I think that Solar's still got a good story. It's out of favor because, obviously, the Trump administration is in no way, shape, or form supporting it. Even though everybody else in the entire planet believes it. Yeah. Interestingly, solar employs more people than coal and oil combined now. There are more people in America, more people working solar than working coal and oil put together. Yet, Trump wants to bring back coal instead of boosting solar. Even though every other country in the world is investing heavily in solar technology, we're going to be the cavemen of the new energy age. We're, you know, that's the goal of this administration. We're supposed to be the last coal users on Earth. That's the energy plan. I have no idea what they're doing. I mean, it's just really, really sick stuff. Anyway, the solar is just generally out of favor. FSLR just had a disastrous report, but FSLR sucks. I hate them. They're the worst solar company. And then you get compared to SolarCity, and SolarCity is not, you know, the SolarCity thing was a disaster too, but that's not a solar company. Somehow I make solar panels. People do use solar panels. They're not installers. They're not retailers and whatever. They make solar panels and people sell them. They make really good ones. And there are other countries are pushing solar, like China, and SunPower sells into that market too. So, you know, the long-term future-looking investment, yeah, it's going to be solar. Also, it's like computers, okay? In other words, like computers in 1980s were $3,000, $4,000 to have a desktop computer, and they had no power, right? That's what solar panels are like now. Solar panels are only X amount efficient and create so many watts per thing, per panel, and so on and so forth, and cost a lot of money. What's going to start happening, though, is they're going to come down and down and down in price, and they're going to get more and more and more efficient. And in the same way that this big clunky desktop you used to have that did nothing in 1985 is now like a phone you hold in your hand that does 100 times more in 2017, in 20 years and 40 years, you're going to see such incredible improvements in solar that it will be the only thing that people use. Those, all those same kind of improvements are going to come, the efficiency and everything else. And I think the figure is 1,000 times more energy hits the Earth from the sun every day than we use all year. If you convert it to electricity. So if we captured all the sun's energy that falls on the planet in one day, we could power the Earth for like 1,000, 4,000 years. So that's how much solar energy we're wasting or not using all the time. And obviously, you don't want to use it all because, I mean, think about, you know, covering the Earth in a solar panel. But you don't have to. That's the point, though. The point is you only need a tiny amount of solar panels compared to the land mass of the planet to power the entire planet. And so eventually, it will get cheap enough and efficient enough that that's what's going to happen. Just like if I told you in 1985 that every single person on Earth is going to walk around with their own portable computer in their pocket, you would be like, that's never going to freaking happen. And plus, how would they ever afford it? It costs millions and blah, blah, blah. And it'll all those barriers fall apart. Solar is, the reason you can predict that with solar is because it really is basically just chips. It's electronics and chips, and it's the same, it follows the same kind of pattern, the same production efficiencies and all the other stuff that computers have. There's no difference. It's the same kind of ramp-up schedule. So solar power is inevitable. And so solar power, and who made the money in the computer? Who was the long-term players in the computer? The chip makers and the computer makers were the ones that made all the money. All right? And now it's the phone makers that are making all the money. But that's, you know, for now we're not worried about that. Down the road, there will be different forms of solar conversion that will probably make more money than panel makers, because the panels are going to be ugly and old and useless by then. They'll look at that as, like, you know, one day we'll look at that and say, oh, that was old clunky technology we used to use to convert solar. Now actually with the thing with the OLED, they can actually spray a screen, like the OLED, the stuff that's in OLED, organic light emitting diodes, they can actually turn it into an aerosol, you know, something you can put in an aerosol spray can, and they can paint a TV screen on something. So that kind of technology can be applied to solar, and eventually they'll be able to be like just the exterior of a building, all the parts of a building will be a panel, but you won't even know it's a panel. It'll just be, you know, all these materials that absorb sunlight and convert it to energy. It'll just be like everything, like your car will be a thing that converts sunlight to energy and powers itself. So you know, you just want to be in these kind of names for the long haul. These are going to be, you know, huge winners down the road. I mean, you know, you don't know which ones, but you pick a couple and hold on to them. And again, it's the same thing as anything else. So say, you know, this is why the future is a good discipline for options, though, because for stocks, because in the future, all this happens in 5 minutes, right? It goes down, it goes up, you get a bump, you get out. You know, the same thing. It's down here. It's going to break out over this line over 10. We're going to head up to like 18 or 20 at some point when it starts getting hot again. People are going to get excited about solar for whatever reason. Doesn't need a big reason, just need some reason. People get excited, it'll pop back up. And around 20, we're probably going to sell. And then we'll go find something else to trade. We'll go find a different solar guy we like who's too cheap. They won't be cheap anymore at 20. They'll be 100% more than when we thought they were cheap. You can hold them forever, but, you know, if in an up and down kind of environment like these guys are in, you probably don't want to hold things forever. You better off just get buying when it's low, like we just did, and selling when it's high. But now it's still low enough where I still like them. What are other good longs to play as fresh plays? We have lots of them. You see the watch list the other day. I forget when. Anybody remember what day that was? Watch list. Was it Friday? Thursday? I don't remember. I don't think it was Friday. The word watch comes up a lot. Oh, that I'll show you, which I tend to finish this weekend. No, that's not helpful. At least I referenced it, though. I intended to finish it, but I forgot I had that thing in New York, so I didn't finish anything. Where it said watch list. So that should be added to the watch list, so I didn't do it that day. I wouldn't have done it Wednesday, because Wednesday's our thingy. Was it this long ago? Oh. Yeah. Wait, does that mean there's no instance of the word watch? Is that what I think? No, it's 12. Ah, watch list. There we go. So, oh, it was from a week ago Friday, from the 17th. So that's where it is. It's in chat on the 17th. And what were we looking at? We had Aflac. Oh, wow, he took off. Okay, so I was liking Aflac. I liked ESRX. I like Gilead, of course. I always like Gilead. I like H&R Block. This is only half of a watch list. I like H&R Block. They took off, too. Wow, everyone's doing good. I like LB, of course. We talked about that. That's in our portfolio. Macy's is in our portfolio. SVU is now there's one you can pick up. They're hitting the bottom again. Target. Can't argue with that. Target will be added to the options opportunities portfolio today or tomorrow. Whole Foods. What are our two pictures of Whole Foods? Don't know. And here's Exxon, which we did add to the long-term portfolio, and they're popping now. So that's it. Okay, so you see, like when Exxon's coming down here, I was liking it. And even though it goes lower, it's like, so what? It's a better opportunity to buy it, and then it pops up higher. You gotta, you know, if you're buying fundamentals, you gotta wait. So that's about halfway through my watch list. I still have 100 other stocks I need to go over and finalize the list. But those are the first dozen picks on the watch list. Our watch list usually do very well. So I can hedge my house exposure with NG contracts. Yes, I like it. I don't know if I hedge that. I don't know if I bet the house on it, but can you talk about SLW? Wait. Okay. Can you talk about what is happening in SLW? What is happening? So something happened today? Or just in general? Yeah, nothing. Okay. So I think you mean why they're down and whatever. Look, Silver Wheaton has a dispute with the Canadian taxing people, whatever they're called. And the dispute is that the way they recognize their revenues in foreign countries, they treat it like it's not profits until we net it out. And Canada's saying, no, if it's a profit there, and you know, they're saying it's not a profit until we repatriate it and net it out into Canada. You know, which, you know, kind of makes sense because you're like, well, if I made a profit in another country, but it's still in the other country, I don't have the money to pay you. And the cost of bringing the money back varies, so therefore, you know, I have to then declare the net when it comes in. But anyway, so, you know, they're doing business all over the world with silver miners all over the world. They have all these complicated contracts and relationships. So just like, you know, in your portfolio accounts, you may have a gain that your account says you have to declare this gain. You're like, what are you talking about? I don't have the money. I only have it on paper. Why would I want to declare that in my taxes? That's kind of where Silver Wheaton is. So they've been in this long drawn-out fight with the Canadian taxing authorities. It's been going on for more than a year, and every once in a while, people freak out about it. We did the math the other day, and the total amount of dispute, 5 years worth of taxes, plus interest, plus penalties, if they get hit for the entire thing that the Canadian government is asking for, is going to be $265 million. But if you think about that, first of all, it's a past thing. It's like any of those disasters, like BP. Look what happened to BP after they finalized the bill for the cleanup. And the auto companies, when they do the recalls and whatever, and Toyota, right, when they pay their fines, and even Volkswagen. When you pay it, when you're done, it's in the past, and you move forward. What matters is your impact on cash flow going forward, and it's extremely negligible for Silver Wheaton. Not only that, but if you say, you know, and of course the Bears' argument also is to say, okay, well, if that's true, then from now on, they're going to have to pay this amount. Well, since they have been in this dispute, that's what they have been paying. So the earnings and revenues they have now are based on this new taxing regime. So that's for one thing. Second of all, it's only, without the fees and penalties, it's only about $25 million a year. It's not materially impactful on their earnings. So these sell-offs are ridiculous. Worry about the core business. Don't worry about the issue. Well, if it was a bigger issue, I'd worry about it, but it's not. And it's people are just dragging this down. It's very strange. But that happens a lot. We see that. Some of the best plays we get into are based on the fact that people don't do math, and it's amazing. Like Baker Hughes. I did the math on Baker Hughes for 2 freaking years. I'm like, okay, they're either going to get bought or they're going to get this incredibly huge breakup fee. And I think the breakup fee was what, like $3 billion or something like that. And I'm like, they only made $1.5 billion in their best year ever. They're going to get 2 years' worth of profits dropped on them for doing nothing. Right? It's just math. It's like, how could you get – it was inescapable math. They're either going to get bought for a much higher price or they're going to get $3 billion. Yet people were not buying the stock. It was just sitting there and sitting there and sitting there for 2 full years. And in the end, I actually said, because it was still down, I said at this point, I would rather if the deal falls apart and they get their money. It's better for them to get the money, keep all their stuff, and have $3 billion in their pocket. And that turned out fantastic. Wait, maybe you can see it on here, because it didn't happen that long ago. So this was my runner-up stock of the year. Way back here for 2015, Baker Hughes was my runner-up for stock of the year because the reason it didn't get it is because I thought that the deal might not go through and it would be like I thought what would happen would happen. It would be choppy because first there's a deal, here's the announcement of the deal, then it goes back down, and that's why I wanted to make it stock of the year. I was like, this is stupid because either the deal is going to go through or they're going to get $3 billion, but to be the stock of the year, I had to know when, you know, I had to be sure it wasn't going to be down here when the options finalized, so I didn't want to do that. But, I mean, I just saw this as like something that couldn't possibly go wrong. And it was just so crazy. And the craziest thing was when this I could understand, but when it started doing this, and last year we're in the 30s and 40s for 6 months. There's no logic whatsoever to that trade. There was no possible way you could do math for me and show me how they are not worth $50 at least. So as most, you know, the members know, I was pounding my, every time. The way I do it with Gilead now, whenever someone says, how do you get, you know, what's a good put? Gilead. What's a good thing to buy? Gilead. That's what I do now. I was doing that with Baker Hughes. I every time you needed an offset, I'm like, oh, you sell some Baker Hughes puts. Because to me, it was just free money. Just sell Baker Hughes put, free money. All right, I feel that way about Gilead now. That's my new one that I bang the table on all the time. Gilead, they got to look ugly. Let's see. Oh, Gild. Gilligan. Gilead, I'm not as good as I thought. See, now they're coming back. I hate that because then I have to find something else. Then I have to go do all the homework and find something else I love because now it's going to get more expensive. But look at Gilead, down. This whole time, ever since about 80, I've been banging the table on Gilead. I don't care how low it goes. It's still worth more than 80. That's all I care about. And if I can sell an $80 put on something that's worth more than 80, I think that's a great deal. So Gilead's one that keeps popping up, and I say, let's do an offset. I don't remember what the topic was, but whatever we were talking about. Any suggestions for fresh TZRSQQ? The one that we rolled to today would be a fresh one. That's brand new, but it's not complicated. I mean, look, there's TVA. How are we doing on this? Nothing exciting going on at all. Weapon of oil. Oh, we got to look at the 1 p.m. report. Forgot about that. Oh, damn it. Not getting any action today. So what was your question? What made me look over there? Oh, TVA, right. Okay. So, trade all products. TVA. TVA 17 is an ultra, okay? So if the Russell falls 10%, they'll go up 30%. 30% of 17 is $5. Okay, so if we go ahead now, obviously 2019, now the problem is if you do a spread in 2019, that's not going to do you any good because it's not going to move. You have to have a certain delta on the spread. At 17, so here, if we could sell these $15 calls, all right, now let's say 20s. Then you have to decide how you want to play it. So let's just take a light hedge, okay? Let's just say if it goes worse. So if you get the 15s for $4, okay, somebody just bought them for $4 right there. If you get the 15s for $4, now what can we sell for $2? Oh, we can go all the way up here, the 24th. You can add, obviously these are going to be more. This 2 and 238, this one's 176 and 223, this one's 165 and 209. You're not going to get $2 for those. You are going to get $2 for these. So basically, you can sell the 23s for $2. You can buy the 15s for $4. Oops, down here, 15s for $4. So now you have the 15-23 spread. You have an $8 spread that's in the money for net $2. You have $6 of upside. So if the Russell falls 5%, 10%, these will go up to 23. You're going to hit your goal. The spread will be 100% of the money, and you'll get back $8 on your $2 investment. That's without any kind of offset. Then there it goes back to here. Then we go back to Gilead. And I say, what do you want to own if the market drops 20%? How about we own Gilead and we sell the $60 calls for $6? So let's see now. That means if you sell you're going to buy 500 shares of Gilead for $60, right? That's $30,000 you're committing to buy Gilead. Obviously, you don't do it with something you don't really want to buy, but you commit to buying 500 shares of Gilead for $60, that's going to be $30,000. You're going to get paid $6 per contract, so that's going to be $3,000. Okay? So you buy five of those. So you sell five puts, the $60 Gilead 2019 $60 puts, and you buy TZA, and you buy the October 15 calls, and sell the 23s for two. You have $3,000, so you can do 15 of those spreads for the same money that you sold the puts, for the same $3,000. You can do 30, and you'll end up paying, you'll pay $3,000 total, but your upside is going to be 30 times 8 is $24,000. So you get $24,000 worth of downside protection for $3,000 net. And don't forget, the $15 calls are $6,000 in the money to start. So unless the Russell goes up from here, you're going to get $3,000 at least. Anything lower is more than $6,000 back in your pocket. So you're going to get a double. And again, assuming Gilead doesn't tank, but you're going to get it. You know, if it, assuming the Gileads expire worthless eventually, you will get net. You will double your money if the Russell is flat. You will. You can get up to 8 times your money back if the Russell goes higher. Or you can just do the 15, and that would give you 15 times 8 in protection, which is 10. Wait, that doesn't make sense. 15 times 8. 12, that makes more sense. Okay, so then you have $12,000 in protection for $1,500. And then you would have zero cash out of pocket, and the only thing you'd have is that obligation to buy Gilead if it goes below 60. So as a fresh hedge, how could you not love that? That's a fantastic setup. And you're protected all the way to October. Is SLW still a trade of the year? Is it still 2017? Is it? Let's see. Hang on. Yes, it is. Yes, and then SLW is still the trade of the year. I hope you went along coffee at 142. Wait, coffee I have. Yeah, we did that already, right? Sure, we looked at that. That's already doing well. Solar panels can't scale like that. Efficiency, you'll never get more than blah, blah, blah. You know, you say that, but meanwhile, they said the same thing about processors, and then they figured out how to, like, layer them on top of each other. So it's hard to say what, it's hard to say where it's going to stop. They're going to keep coming out with more and more ways to take advantage. They're coming about with different designs and cubes and so on and so forth. I mean, obviously, you're not going to get 1,000 times efficiency because you'd be more efficient. You'd be generating more power than, you know, conservation of energy kicks in at some point. But you can get them up to really high levels of efficiency. They're going to be much more than enough to power any need that you have. And that's the key. If the cost comes down, then it all works out. Farm profits up front. Carrot tax with farm profits up front. That's bullshit. Oh, the beige book. I didn't know we were doing that. Ugh, I don't feel like it. Let's get that. What about RH instead? Yeah, we like, oh, RH is great. Those puts are fantastic. I agree 100%. Those are also great puts. I said that this morning in chat. The solar panels know it's thermodynamically impossible. Yeah, we know that. Okay, so we're going to be less than 100%, probably 50%. I think 50% is the limit, but I also think that they'll figure out ways to, like, layer the panels and bring another, you know, like, have more efficiency in the space. So, what you know, your definition of a solar panel may change. Yeah, I know we're going to look at the crude stockpiles. All right, let's start off with the EIA. I'm really on the mood for the beige book bullshit, but I will do it. I will look. So oil. Step one, imports. Imports were down a bit. Exports were still the same as they were last week. They weren't that incredibly high. We saw a chart that showed something like some huge amount of tankers are being put into service. So it's kind of hard to tell what's going on with oil. It's a little tricky. It's basically, it's flat overall, 2044, 2044. They did not take the oil out of the SPR yet, and they're not going to now until, like, May and June. So that's off the table as far as the catalyst to push oil lower. Other things are really flat. Oil production is up a little bit. Distillate's up a bit. That's up a bit. Refinery utilization has come down. So it's interesting. They're producing more, but the refineries are only at less capacity. It's interesting. Inputs to the refineries is the same. The production of each item is the same. This is a very blah-de-blah report. But then you say, well, if it's a blah-de-blah report, why are we higher than we were at the last report? Why, if nothing has changed, why has the price changed? And then why is the price $22 higher. Why is the price 66% higher than it was last year? When we have more oil. See here, look. Last year we had 2010, now we have 2044. We have more oil in storage. Okay? Last year, product supplied 19.6, now it's 19.8, same basic product supplied, yet 66% higher price. I mean, first of all, it shows you how inelastic demand is, right? Doesn't matter what you charge, we're going to use the same amount of oil. So there's been no kickback on the consumers at this price. They've done nothing to curtail their consumption here. But it's a nothing report. There's nothing going on here. So, like I said, I'm holding my short. So I just think there's no catalyst, and no catalyst eventually is going to drift a bit lower. But it's nothing to get excited about in either direction. Now, for the much less interesting, beige book. Okay, let's try to stick to the highlights. Oh, yeah, that's right. They changed the beige book. Oh, I'm off the hook. They changed the beige book, so it's like you don't have to really read it anymore. That's actually not good, though. Because if they're changing it so you don't read it, it means you better read it. All 12 districts indicated the economy expanded at a modest to moderate pace. From January to February, consumer spending expanded modestly since the last report. Retail sales increased at a subdued pace. Now, what is the difference between a moderate pace and a subdued pace? It would be nice to have a little footnote for that to figure out what these things mean. A number of districts noting an ongoing shift from in-store to internet purchasing. So all that means is that the meme of all these people bitching about things moving online, it catches on. Because don't forget the beige book. It's just a Fed talking to their buddies who own businesses. So like the Atlanta Fed chairman, he has his pals and businesses in the various districts, and they go around and they talk to them. They sit down. It's basically a chance to go out to lunch with everybody for a couple of weeks. So they go down, they meet with the guys, they walk around their place, and they talk about the business. He says, what are your prospects? And they have a little checklist. One of these systems goes check, 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 check. And that's how the beige book is put together. It's really, you know, it's very anecdotal. It's not factual at all. So this is why you see, if people start talking about internet purchasing, it becomes a thing here. And so they talk about internet purchasing. So lots of people are complaining about the internet, basically. Auto sales varied widely, but were said to be up in most districts. Varied widely, but up in most districts. That's interesting. Tourism was mixed, but like mostly stronger. Manufacturing activity accelerated somewhat. I love these modifiers. With most districts characterizing the pace of growth as moderate, not subdued, but moderate. I think I'm going to start looking at moderate and think, wow, thank God it's not subdued. The energy sector showed modest growth. Okay, in other words, very, very slow growth. Okay, and that came across in the GDP report yesterday, 2% growth. This is what 2% growth looks like. It's slow, moderate, subdued. Those are the words of 2% GDP growth. They are not the words of an all-time market high. I hate to tell you. That's out of control. The transport activity is steady. Ooh, steady. That's good. Steady to somewhat higher across the nation. Home construction sales continue to expand modestly in most districts. Rental mixed home prices were steady and up modestly in most districts. A number of districts noted low inventory of existing homes. We saw that. Commercial real estate construction grew modestly, and sales and leasing grew moderately. So is modestly more or less than moderately? So it's hard to figure out whether or not they're building enough homes if you can't tell the difference between modestly and moderately. Lending activity was steady to somewhat higher. Ooh. I guess you can get clues to what they mean by somewhat by if you keep paying attention. This is not normal. This is like weird that they're suddenly putting in all these odd modifiers. Businesses are generally optimistic about the near-term outlook, but to a somewhat lesser degree from the prior reports. They're still optimistic, but they're not quite seeing the Trumpiness coming through. So on the ground, when you actually talk to these guys, it's not quite as good as it's being made out to be. Labor markets remain tight, we know that. Labor shortages, okay. Employment grew modestly, district characterized growth as modest. Number of districts known as staffing firms are seeing brisk business. Staffing firms, we got. And noted more conversions from temporary permanent workers. In general, wages in most districts rose modestly or moderately, with a few reporting some pickup. Well, now, if they're saying that wages rose modestly or moderately, then those are very small numbers, because wages are not up more than a couple of percent. So modestly and moderately, now we know, are very, very, very small numbers. With a few reporting pickup in the pace, a number of districts noted shortages of skilled workers. That's been going on forever, especially IT. Yeah, I got my daughter. I told Jackie to try to see if she has. They offer a coding class in school. I told my daughter, I said, look, try it. Maybe you're good at it. You know, she's really good at math. So I said, but if you're good at coding, you're set for life. Because that's basically one of the few jobs that will be left in 20 years. They're driving up their wages, and there were also some reports of labor shortages, leisure and hospitality, construction, and manufacturing. All this labor stuff is going to start biting us in the ass at some point. They will have to start paying people more to show up for work. You know what? I read an article that was people are job hopping. You can't get a raise from a company rent. Companies, basically, they have all these things in place to make sure they don't raise wages. They have all these policies that make it so almost impossible to get a good raise in the company unless you're promoted. So absent of a promotion, you can't get a raise. So a lot of people are doing the same thing I used to do in when I was a kid back in the 80s. We used to quit, if we didn't get a 10% raise, we would quit and go get another job that paid us more. And you wouldn't even have another job. You just quit and then open the paper up and say, okay, how much do I want to make? It was easy to get a job. it was too easy to get a job. That was bad. That caused inflation. It was bad for the employers, but it was great for people. That's coming back. People are doing that now. It's funny. I read it. I'm like, oh yeah, that's what it used to be like. You know, and you see jobs everywhere, and you just decide how much you want to get paid. And if you're a capable person, you can basically walk up and say, no, I need 60, not 50. You know, and they'd be like, oh, okay. But to do that these days, you can't do it within the company you're in. You generally have to quit and go get another job, and it's happening more and more. People are quitting jobs to go get jobs that pay better. And that's the first step towards having serious rising wages. Because then companies realize how hard you are to replace, and they suddenly realize they have to start getting their employees' wages in order to keep them. And that's something there are company managers, people in their 40s have lived their whole lives and have no idea how this works. You know, they've grown up thinking employees are these expendable things. That if they get rid of one, they just get another one in 2 seconds. It doesn't work like that once you get into a low unemployment. It's very, very different. A lot of these young managers, they have no idea. They don't understand the concept of employee retention. It's not even a thing they worry about. It's going to be very nasty learning curve for them. Pricing pressures, little change. Most issues, selling prices were up moderately. Four out of 12 had largely leveled off. Input prices were up modestly. Energy prices and farm prices were mixed but steady on balance, while construction materials climbed. Overall business activity said they expected both input prices, selling prices to go up moderately. So everyone has moderate expectations of inflation. Highlighted by district, Boston. See, I didn't like that. I liked it when they had the sectors. See, they used to do it where you'd look at the sector and it would talk about the districts. Now they talk about each district. It's not a good way to do these reports. Business contacts, moderate to modest overall increases. You have some things. So in other words, it used to be that we would read the report and they would talk about manufacturing. And they would say, talk about the different districts in the manufacturing. They talk about retail sales in the different districts. But the topic was retail sales, not each district. How do I get a picture of how retail sales are doing when each one of these reports randomly either does or does not mention retail sales? It's a terrible, terrible change they made to this report. Now I remember why I'm not excited about reading. I used to love reading. Business contacts in most sectors, moderate, blah, 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 staffing firms, modest declines. That's the same bullshit. Most contacts cited positive outlook. New York, here I care about New York. Economic activities accelerated, modest pace, labor markets have strengthened, hiring picked up, wages rising modestly, input costs have become more widespread, selling prices accelerated, housing markets continue to weaken at the high end, and commercial real estate has picked up. Who else is a big important city? Chicago. Growth picked up at a moderate pace. Employment wages, business spending, manufacturing all grew at a moderate pace. Consumer spending increased modestly. Construction and real estate rose slightly. Financial conditions will change. All right, well, hey, maybe Dallas. Shouldn't Dallas have, like, something good because they've got all the oil? Here, let's see. Economic activity grew moderately. Outlooks remained optimistic. The energy sector noted improvement demands and signs of pick up in hiring. Manufacturing service activity continued to expand. And although there was increased uncertainty surrounding the new administration's policy changes, loan activity increased and housing demand remained solid. See, that's a good report. And they better have a good report because they're freaking Dallas. That's where all the oil is. San Francisco, that's where all the tech is. Economic activity expanded at a moderate pace. Retail goods picked up and activity in the consumer business sector slowed slightly. What? Consumer and business services slowed slightly. Manufacturing was mixed. Activity in the agriculture sector is unchanged. What agriculture? Oh, they got the grapes. Yeah, that's true. Activity in the housing market was unchanged from the prior period, but remained strong. All right, so nothing. So it's a blah-de-blah report, not very exciting. And again, though, it's like, you know, it doesn't matter because the Dow is now 21,155. It doesn't matter that it's a blah report. And it's just going to go up anyway. The market's going to go up until it has some damn good reason to go down, but I can't imagine what that's going to be. Bell Labs put in a limit of 38% in the book in the 50s. GSL has three layers in the upper ground in the mid-40s now, which is sick. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. They don't know. Nobody freaking, oh, come on. I mean, in 1985, did anyone have any clue that we would have these Pentium chips and things that we have now? No. It wasn't even imagined. There wasn't even a possibility that we would get to this point. Now we've got, like, you know, now we've got what can we call it? Well, now we're just quantum computing. So we're breaking through that barrier. You know, you don't know, because every time they design the next generation, they start looking at things a little bit differently, and new people come, and new eyes, and fresh eyes get on it. You know, back in the 50s, there were like eight guys on the whole planet who cared about these things enough to look at it. So you're stacking up the imagination of eight people against the imagination of 50,000, 100,000 people who look at this thing every day now and who trained on this stuff and who imagined it from when they were kids. It's how technology advances. I mean, as things get more and more widespread, more and more people who have ideas come in to take a look at it from different angles, and then eventually somebody comes through with something better. So I've got TZA long, TZA blah, blah, blah. 17, oh, I don't know what that is. What is that? 0721, I mean, I'm not the frickin' thinkorswim database. I've got TZA long. Let's see if we can figure out what she's got. It says C15. To me, that's a $15 call. TZA long. But TZA. I'm sorry, you're going to have to translate that into something like English. I should note, I'm not disagreeing with you on a solo premise, just pointing out the bounding expectations. Yeah, I understand. No, I'm just saying, I'm pointing out that by having gone through it with PCs and heard all that, my father was a systems analyst, so I've been in computers since I was born, basically. And he was a high-level guy, so we used to have these conversations with what was possible and what would happen in the future and what the limits of technology. And I've been in rooms with guys who would be, you know, top-notch IBM guys and whatever, and they would be saying, no, I would stake my reputation that you can't possibly do this and that, and then 2 years later, boom, it's done. I don't bet against technology advancing. Then go short TVA. Okay, still make. The year? I have TVA 2019, April, if it's this year, you say the month. If it's next year, you're going to say 2018. If it's the year after that, you say 2019. It's this year. It's either January, February, March, April, May, June, July, August, whatever. So I have the May 15 call and whatever. Then I can answer the question. But I can't answer the question when I have to figure out the code of what you're saying. What is your opinion of airline stocks? So, okay. I don't need to know the July 21st. The date is completely unimportant. It's a July 15 call. So you're a long July 15 call. That's where I am so far. I don't understand what short TVA 721 means. Hey, I want you to say, oh my God, okay. Don't care about that. Doesn't matter when they expire. What do you own? You own the July 21st? You own the July $15 call? You're long on those or you're short on those? I have no clue what your position is from the way you're putting it. All right, well, while he comes to grips with that, I mean, look, hang on. Let me just put out a trade. Now, let's look at here. I'll show you on top here. This is what I want you to do, man. Go to top trades. See this? Buy 1,000 GME at that much. That's a stock. Well, in that case, that's a stock. Let's not look at that one. Change my mind. All right, here. SVU, sell 50, 2019, 350 puts at 70. So you would say, Phil, I have 50 long, 2019. I have 50 short, 2019 calls at this price. I sold this many puts at that price. It's very simple if you lay it out like that. It doesn't matter what date they expire, what day they expire in 2019, January like 21st, 2019. That doesn't matter. What matters is 2019. And if it's July, it's July. It doesn't have to be, the day of July doesn't matter. It's that I own this many this month, this strike, quits or calls, and I paid this much money for it. That's the way you format it. So you have a 15-19 spread that apparently is in July. That's what it seems like to me. But I don't even know what the question is anymore. You're acting like I'm remembering everything you've got here. Are you asking what my pick was? Because that wasn't what we talked about just now. We talked about an $8 spread. You're talking about a $4 spread. Are you saying you have a $4 spread already? Look, ask me this stuff in chat, okay? Because really, this is not a good format for doing this. I think you made an adjustment to TVA in one of our short calls. Okay. I did that because here, TVA. If you're in the, I guess you're in the options opportunity portfolio. We just did this today, though. I don't understand. It's like I just sent out the notice. Ooh, we gain 1% while we're waiting. Isn't that nice? It's like $5,000. Okay, in the options opportunity portfolio, which has gained 3% while we've been sitting here. This is great. Intraday pricing is so insane. All right. Let's see. All right, we had the 15-19 bull call spread in July. We sold the March 22 calls. Those are going to expire worthless. They are already worthless. Okay? We sold them. See how smart that is? We bought the July spread. We bought 40. We bought the 40 spread for $1.50, basically. We sold for 50 cents since we sold half. We sold for 50 cents. We covered. So now our net on the spread is only $1. On the 15-19 spread. And where's TVA now? 17. This trade is profitable. We're in the money. But we want a better hedge. So we took advantage of that today, and and I sent out an alert. So what was the alert? What did we say? Okay, but maybe this is very inefficient for me to read you the thing that I wrote. TZA. We paid net $280 for the spread. $280. Which one's that? Oh no, that's a January spread. We're talking about the other one. Okay, the second set, that's what I'm talking about, has 40, July 15, so there's still $3.50, and we only paid $166 for the spread. So let's invest $4 more. So we're going to sell those for $3.50. We're going to add $4 cash, and we're going to purchase the October $10 calls for $7.50. So we're going to take the 40 July 15 calls, we're going to sell them, and we're going to buy the October $10 calls for more money. Now, what are we doing there effectively? Well, we're moving down $5 in strike, and we're buying 3 months in time. August, September, so yeah. We're buying 3 months of time and buying $5 in strike. So putting ourselves deep in the money and doing that. Why are we doing that? Because then we get to sell more calls. We're going to leave the March 19 calls because they will expire worthless, or we will roll them. So now instead of having a, see what we've done is we've increased our spread. We spent $4 to get $5 more of it being in the money. We bought more time, and the more time is important though, because if TZA pops up, we can easily roll these to a longer period and roll them higher and widen the spread further without spending any more money. So if it's more in the money, we're going to roll those calls. If it's less in the money, if it's below where TZA is now, we will be able to sell lower calls because now we have the $5 calls. We'll be able to sell lower calls in the 19th and still have a nice spread. So there's a logic to this. We're thinking ahead of the possible things that can happen. Also, we may as well buy back the March 22s because now I'm worried. Since we already have the 19th with the March 22, I don't want to get burned on a big move down that pops TZA. So just in case, the 8 cents, we may as well just buy them back and be done with it. That way we don't think about it. I think it's $160, but not maybe depending on how many we have. No, it's like $160, it shouldn't be $1,600. Anyway, all right, so that puts us in a longer, short position. So hopefully that's what you're talking about, because otherwise I can't figure that. Can you please comment on FTR? Look, FTR. Okay, Frontier, they just bought. What they did is, Frontier is a phone company, regional little phone company. They are trying to build their business up, and what they did is they bought a whole bunch of Verizon customers. So Verizon was dumping, like, you know, some rural customers they didn't want anymore, and Frontier bought their service area, basically, from them. So Frontier, in the transition, there's probably, you know, these guys could probably also use AT&T. Like, Verizon got out, but AT&T is probably still there. Some other guys are still there. So when all of a sudden your phone company says, hey, we're not Verizon anymore, now we're Frontier, some people are going to go, ugh, what's this Frontier crap? And they start shopping around, and they find a better deal, plus the competitors jump all over it. So they jump in there, and they try to steal the business. This is always going to happen when you try to buy your competitor's business. You're always going to have some attrition. So Frontier is in the process of doing their best to maintain the customers that they bought. And the retention is like 90-something percent. That's not the point. The point is they lose 2% and everybody freaks out. But they're retaining 90% of the customers they bought. So basically it means it costs them 10% more than initially than the face value to buy the Verizon customers because they lost not 10%. So it's all about retaining the customers. Then it's also, of course, integrating them into their current system, and there's cost to that, and integration costs and build-up costs, and they have to hire more service people. And all kinds of stuff that's upfront costs, it's just building infrastructure for them, though. The net result is Frontier becomes a bigger company in a footprint that they're comfortable with. But there's a transition that takes a year or two, and it's only started happening in October. So people are impatient. Most people in stock these days are traders. Most people in stock these days aren't even people, they're freaking machines. And nobody wants to be in a long-term investment, building itself up over time. Frontier's got fantastic cash flow. It's a great company. They have a huge barrier to entry in the region. They, you know, they service underserviced customers in rural areas. So the thing is that nobody's going to jump in there and roll all over them. It costs billions of dollars to build that stuff out these days. You know, Frontier is just basically, you know, servicing what they've got, and they're adding services, and they're also losing people to, you know, people are cutting their landlines. That's the problem with Frontier, so they're trying to combat that also. But on the whole, though, it's just like AT&T or Verizon, but on a smaller scale. But with AT&T and Verizon, they have the luxury of patient money that lets them spend billions and billions of dollars and build up their infrastructure to become good, steady cash flow company. Frontier is a good, steady cash flow company, but of course it's erratic because they try to spend on infrastructure. They don't have the kind of money that the other guys have, so they have to borrow some, and they have to establish lines of credit and do this and that. But it's just normal. It's a normal phase of business, and they're going to go up and they're going to go down. But on the whole, they've been rock steady performers that pay out a good chunk of their cash flow and dividend. They have very little trouble. They've got a good moat around their customers because they're in underserved areas. So I really like them. And so we're probably gonna buy more, frankly. I mean, you know, when you're getting right now the dividend on Frontier is 12.5%. And they're being priced like they're gonna go bankrupt. Ooh, Apple testing 140. 292. Yeah, the dividend is 42 cents against 292. That's 12.7% now. That's just crazy. So you look at their financials, and they're down $196 million. They've got $9 billion. Okay, let's put this in perspective, okay? They lost $196 million last year doing all this acquisition. Huge acquisition, doing all this stuff. They're down $196 million. They've got $9 billion. Oh, wait, I'm sorry. They had $9 billion. They spent it. they have $331 million. They started with $9 billion. They spent it because they did the acquisition. That's how much they spent on the acquisition. So obviously people are like, oh, my God, what if something goes wrong? And what if it doesn't pay off and blah, blah, blah? It's, you know, you either trust them to do their job or you don't. But it's a, you know, you told us there's a huge amount of money moving around. They've got it under control. These guys know what they're doing. Or maybe they don't, and it all blows up. But at the moment, I like them. So these adjustments are all for TZA. Yeah, but yeah, the ones that we sent out, it was these adjustments that say TZA are all for TZA. See, it says TZA up here, and so all that's for TZA. This one says SQQ. That's all for SQQQ. What is your opinion of the airline sector? I'm contemplating this. On the one hand, flying's more accessible. As long as oil doesn't get too expensive, the new planes are much more fuel efficient. Fuel is one third of their total cost. So if you look at the airlines and you say, okay, if they replace their fleet with 15-20% more efficient planes, they're going to save 20% of 3% is 6%. 20% of 30%, which is their fuel cost, is 6%. If you're talking about dropping another 6% to the bottom line for these airlines, they are incredibly undervalued. So if they can avoid getting into like airfare wars and they can keep flying the same amount of people for the same amount of money, but on more efficient planes, they will make money. And so for a couple of years at least, they probably will. Then eventually some guy is going to come in, like a Branson kind of guy, is going to come in with a brand new thing. I'll tell you what's killing them. Ryanair now is coming in with really cheap fares. Icelandair is coming in here with cheap fares. There are people coming in hitting this market with cheap fares now, but it's limited. But now here's a dangerous thing for the airlines. Trump, with the deregulation stuff, if he starts deregulating airport access, you talk about a trade restriction, man. We don't allow those European carriers to come to our airport. Those gates are controlled by American Airlines. They get treated like, these foreign carriers get treated like crap at our airport. Otherwise, why do you think they don't fly in our country? They're not allowed to fly in our country. They really, you know, when you go to these Midwestern airports and stuff like that, there's no such thing as Icelandair or Virgin or anything like that. They don't have it. That's why Virgin had to start Virgin America, just so they could get more access to airports. So eventually, a Chinese company, airline company or something like that, is going to buy an American airline company and blow the thing wide open. Because they'll make an alliance connection sort of thing where all the flights come from China and connect through to America, and then they'll start going into fare wars and all kinds of things like that. So down the road, it's going to hit the fan. Short term, though, airlines are probably going to have a great year. I don't like investing in them because they're too weird. And if oil spikes up, of course, that's bad for them, so that's one negative. And at any given time, these fare wars can erupt. See, what happens to the airline industry, and there's nothing that shows that it's not going to happen again, but for the history of the airline industry, they almost go bankrupt, then they start making money, because they had all these reorganizations, and they wrote off a lot of their planes, so they don't pay any taxes, and they've got... and they got out of a lot of their debts. So that's why they start making money. It's like you can make money too if you get a plane for 10 cents on the dollar and you don't have to pay any taxes on your next $1 billion, $2 billion worth of earnings. You know, you'll do well also. So, but they go through these peak and trough periods, and when they peak, what happens is the discount carriers start coming in, because when the big guys peak and they're reaping the rewards of all the cheapness, all of a sudden the discount carriers go, whoa, that's a lot of profit. Let's go in and compete with them. And then discount guys come in, and then all of a sudden there's fare wars, and nobody makes money, and then people go bankrupt, and then somebody buys a bunch of planes for 10 cents on the dollar, and then everybody starts making money again, and then the cycle goes again. And this is happening my whole life. I'm 55. I'm sure it's going to continue. And it just did happen. I mean, they all did just almost go bankrupt, and they did all consolidate the industry, and now they're making money. It's the same freaking cycle over and over again. It usually lasts for a couple of years, but you'll see it, because you'll suddenly see airfare wars. And as soon as you see airfare wars, start selling your airlines. That's all. But if you look at an airline, like Delta, I think it's one Buffett got into, they're still very cheap. I mean, it's 8.9 because people really hate airlines. Warren Buffett used to hate airlines, but he just only started buying them. They're making $4 billion. There's no growth here. 40, and here they made no money for whatever reason. But here, you know, here they made $4 billion. They're making $4 billion. They've got a $40 billion market cap. That's their IP. They literally have a 9 PE. It's just so silly. Maybe we should start looking at airlines. Jeez. That's just comical. And see, they're trading at the same price they were a couple of years ago. This is trailing the average PE of the S&P by 50%. They could go up 100%, they would still be a cheap S&P stock. But, you know, personally, if they, you know, frankly, I'll put them on a watch list, and if they come back down into the 40s, I'll be very happy to sell puts on them and whatever. But even with those numbers, it's just an airline. It's such a scary thing. They're a peak and trough sort of business. So if your goal is to hold them long term, it's not good. But if you're trading them, it's fine. But for long term, I wouldn't really play them. All right, how are you doing time? Oh, 10 to 3. Holy crap. All right. Any other questions? Does Time Warner go away after the merger with T, or will they continue to have individual stocks and options? Don't know. It's a merger. One of them, they're going to combine and do something. You can't trade both. Do tax cuts equal travel? Yeah, I don't think it's going to be a question of whether or not they're going to have a shortage of passengers. I think more to the point, though, is that, like I said, you'll get airfare wars, that they'll be competing for the passengers, and that's where they just cannibalize themselves. It's a fascinating business, because you watch them and you're like, they're on top of the world and they can't sustain it, though. No matter if as soon as things go too good, they all blow themselves up. It's no discipline. It's not much. It's like OPEC, except that they don't. It's like OPEC, except they have a harder time controlling fares. Now, with the Trump administration, it's possible that they'll be able to have a little cartel and control their airfares, because who's going to stop them? You know, they won't have the fear that somebody's going to be hitting with the antitrust or anything. So Buffett has this. Didn't Buffett invest directly in airlines all of a sudden? Which is, well, I can see why, though, if that's the kind of PE he's getting at. What's United? Let's take a look at what United is. It's an interesting one. UAL. I hate United. Ugh. The worst airline I've ever been on. Even worse than Spirit. They basically torture you. Their goal on a plane is to see how much crap you will put up with before you go crazy. So the PE ratio is 11 on these guys, and we're talking about, wow, super erratic earnings. I don't know. I don't know what to say about that. I mean, 1.1, 7.3 that. They're steady sales, so you'd have to look at it and figure out what's going on here. Here they had a tax credit, so take that out, and that's still 4. Still high. Don't know why. I haven't looked at them long enough, so I don't know what's going on. That's kind of crazy, though. So consider that an aberration and figure they're good for a couple of $1 billion. And they are priced, they're market cap higher, though, than Delta, I think. Oh, no, it's not. 23. Okay, so still, yeah, $11 billion is correct. And if we look at the earnings per share, they're making current year, what are we calling the current year? Current quarter is 217. So in the current year, they're making $6.76 for a $75 share. Not bad. And these analysts think that they're going to actually go up another button next year, which makes them even a way better bargain. But again, you know, when you're long term, if oil spikes up to 100, these guys will crash. Realize they got shot. So, you know, you have OPEC trying to put these guys out of business is basically what's happening. And we'll see. But anyway, but I as a small part of a portfolio, I got nothing against buying the stock with a PE of 8. As I said, I hate United. Delta's a good airline, and I think they're probably a good one to invest in. You know, I wouldn't make it a big part of my, I wouldn't make it a big thing in my portfolio, but you know, to put it a little bit, like 5% in and see how it goes, I got no problem with that. Let's take a look at Delta. How can we trade Delta? Let's take a quick look. So Delta's at 51.50. You can sell the 40 puts, 2019 $40 puts, or you can do better than $4 because it says $3.75, $5.25. So figure 50 cents more. At least $3.25. At least probably three. I'm sorry, $4.25. At least $4.25. Probably $4.50. So I would ask $4.50. And that would be my start. See, to start this trade off, I would ask for $4.50. If I get that, I would then think about constructing a trade around it to do it. But let's say if I start off with $4.50, my worst case is I have to buy Delta 20% below where it is now. I got no problem with that. So I consider the $4.50 to be free money. Okay? So having $4.50 in my pocket, what do I think of Delta? I just want to place them to be steady where they are now. So let's say we sell these $50 calls for $9. And now, so how much money did I collect over here? I collected $4.50. So So all those things, I said, okay, so I got $9 here, plus $4.50 is $13.50. What can I buy for $13.50? I can buy the 43s, so that's kind of BS. So why don't I go down here? These are going to be about $16.50. So now I got $16.50 minus 9 is $7.50, minus $4.50, that works out, is 3. So I'm going to net 3 by buying the $38 calls, selling the $50 calls, so it's a $12 spread, and I'm going to end up being in the $12 spread and selling the $40 puts, and then I'm in that spread for a net of $3 per contract in the $12 spread, that's 100% in the money. So unless Delta is lower than it is now in 2019, that spread will pay you back 12 for every 3 you put into it. And your margin shouldn't be so bad. Your margin on selling the 40s, sell single. So if we sell 10, let's say, at not at 375 though, if we sell at 450. Yes, I know you can, as long as they change the method. At this point, I will. Okay, so 450, and we hit that, and we come up with what? 2,500 margin. See, that's pretty nice, right? Because this spread is 2,500 in margin, 3,000 in cash, and the return, and all Delta has to do is hold $50, the return is $12,000. So it's a nice, efficient trade. It's a good thing. And the worst thing that happens is you own Delta for net 43. That's your worst outcome on this trade. So it's a very, very good way to get into this thing. That actually wouldn't be bad in the long-term portfolio. It's very good. All right. Going to have to wrap this one up. NKD. Oh, damn it. No, thank you. I didn't actually want to hold that overnight. I just want to see how it went. How we do is probably up. NKD, yep, it's up. I'll see how it goes into the close. That's going to be my plan. All right, oh, look, see, that got worse. Wow! Boy, did that pop back up. Damn it. 50 points on 20 contracts. That is annoying. All right, nothing we can do about that. All right, so VK is now down. It was up, but now it's down, so unfortunately. I'm going to see what happens in the close. If we have a strong close, I'm going to get out of this. I'm going to cut those back to 10, and then we'll see what happens tomorrow. That's my plan. Oil's doing better, at least, and it was a nice little gain on oil. And how's coffee doing? Let's see. The last one we'll look at is coffee. KCN7, I think it is. Whoa, very nice. $2,800. That's cool. Now, coffee, I really do want to hold these until the summer. I'm not too keen on selling it. But as I said, though, we did sell them here, even though we wanted to buy them for the long term. We sold them here. We bought them back down here a little bit. And now they're coming back up. And I would love to see them come back up here in the 150. You know, but even though I have a lot of faith in it, I don't know. It's going to be a lot of money. It's going to be like $5,000-$6,000 profit. It's kind of hard to turn down, right? All right, so the saga continues. Hopefully these Dow things will get better. Uh-oh, wait, another question. You can't do that. We're done. What do we do with the Apple call for 2017 that we're still short on for 2017? Okay. The Apple call for 2017 that was still short on for 2017. Is there an Apple call up here that I missed? No. These 110 calls, right? We moved those. Apple. The 10 short 110 calls at 31 are market NASDAQ hedge. All right, but they're too deep in the money. So these are also a hedge because the market goes down, they'll pay us off. Let's buy that. We're buying back those. We sold 30 June 135 instead. Okay, so if you look at the portfolio, we have 30 longs. Now we have sold 30 short. We moved these to 30 short, from 10 to 30 short 135. So basically, we're just at this point, we're just selling premiums. Now, the Junes, we have to keep an eye on these, but the Junes, so you never think it's just the one thing you're doing. AAPL. So now we have 30, and we're in the June 135. All right, and they're like $9. So down the road, though, now what happens to these things? Well, if we're still in the money, because right now they are pretty much in the money. Well, they're only half in the money. I mean, they're 135 calls and $9. Half of that money is premium. But in October, for example, if we roll out for a few months, which ones are $9? The 140s are $9, and the 145s are $7.50. So if I spend $1.50, I could roll these short calls up to the 145, so I'll gain $10 in strike. So again, unless Apple goes completely apeshit and hits 170, I'll be able to roll these things out of trouble over time. Also, though, I could sell some puts to offset them, and there's all kinds of things you can do. So just because I'm selling the 135s now doesn't mean I intend to target 135. It just means I think that Apple is toppy enough off here that it's probably not going to burn us, and we'll be able to roll ourselves out of trouble. And you know, we've got the, and also you have to realize, you know, you have these 15 puts, they're going to expire worthless, so we're going to collect that money. We can sell 15 more puts. There's a lot of stuff we can do, but for now, we didn't want to, you know, we just wanted to take these, which are too deep in the money to do us any good, and we put them into ones that have more premium and expire sooner. So that was the purpose of that move in Apple. Anyone confirm the Nikkei? All right, the Nikkei position is off. Forget that. That's just our, we were shorting it just to see how it would go. 10 short Apple 19. Oh, there's another one. January 19th, 2018. Right. That's the, well, those are the ones we're talking about. Okay, great. All right, now we're done. With a wide-ranging discussion. All right, guys. Well, thanks for coming, and we'll do it again next week. All right, take care. Adjustment. All those adjustments were today in the options opportunity portfolio. Those are the adjustments we made. Right here, Wednesday at, and if you're from a Seeking Alpha member, here, 10:57 in member chat. And if you're an options opportunity person, then a post would have come up in Seeking Alpha. All right, now she's got it. Okay, good. Now I feel better. All right, guys, take care.